Okay, hello YouTube. Today we're going to be talking about this continuing controversy between Magnus Carlsen and Hans Niemann. So as maybe many of you are aware, or maybe many of you weren't aware, they played a game where Magnus Carlsen basically resigned in protest. The game was not relevant, d4, knight f6, c4, and Magnus Carlsen resigned, presumably out of protest for suspicions that he has of Hans Niemann, and of course the internet's, you know, all ablaze about that, what the suspicions might be, you know, whether it's, you know, leaked preparation or whether it's some type of cheating, some type of computer cheating that Magnus Carlsen is convinced that Hans Niemann did. So instead of speculating on, you know, what Magnus thinks or why Magnus is protesting, because there hasn't really been any statement on this, what this video is going to be dedicated to is just trying to explain to you, maybe the non, you know, professional chess playing public, and of course, like the non, you know, chess computer people, exactly how cheating is detected online. Now, I'm no expert on exactly how it's done. I have a vague outline on how exactly cheat detection is done. But I intend to share that vague outline with you. I've actually spent, you know, several hours talking to people that do cheat detection. I'm not going to name any names or say who they do cheat detection for. And I'm going to try to give away as few specific details as possible on how they do it, just because I don't want to make it easier for people that are actually trying to get away with cheating. But I will reveal, like, kind of the general outline on how cheat detection is done. And I'm going to talk about, like, why it's not what people think it is, you know. So a lot of people out there seem to think that cheat detection is just, well, we look at, you know, if somebody has a really high accuracy rate, we look at that and we determine that they're cheating. Or, you know, if somebody's accuracy rate is really, really high. Or if somebody beats somebody that they're not supposed to beat, like if a weaker player beats a GM. So as you may or may not know, I'm only a national master, you know, really at the height of my skills. You know, my best rating was right around 2300 over the board in classical chess. But I've actually beaten quite a few grandmasters in my tournament history. And even when I, you know, was playing actively, I had beaten a few grandmasters, even in, you know, rated tournament games. I beat John Elvest in a rated quick game one time. I've played several grandmasters in, you know, blitz games and pickup games, and I've won some of those games. And actually, even online, I just, you know, wanted to show that I've actually played several grandmasters online, and I've won, I've lost, I've drawn, you know, and, you know, I've won maybe more than people think I should win against grandmasters. And some of those accuracy levels that I have, you know, some of you are like, ooh, 98.5, you know, that looks pretty suspicious, you know. But here's something that I want to point out. I have never once been flagged for cheating on the internet, and I've never even been close to getting flagged for cheating on the internet. And that's because cheat detection isn't just about looking at how closely a move relates to the computer. You know, I know a lot of you are saying, well, he could have got around, you know, if Hans cheated, he could have got around it by only cheating on one or two moves, or he could have picked the second or third pick to throw him off and all this other stuff. Cheat detection is actually quite a bit more sophisticated than that. When you're playing a game, like, let's take a look at this game that I had here where I was rated 2367 and I was playing against a GM and, oh wait, no, this one with my 98%, accuracy level. So let's take a look at this and let's see, like, why did the cheat detection never go off for this game, even though I played with a very high accuracy level. I only had some inaccuracies. I never made any bad moves, you know. And actually, when we look at it now with this engine, it says that my accuracy was only 88.2. So accuracy is kind of it's a moving target, right? It depends which engine they're using. It depends how long they let that engine run. You know, and of course they know that cheaters could also be using multiple different types of engines. They could be using HyArX, they could be using, you know, Houdini, they could be using Stockfish 15. Stockfish 15, Stockfish 14.1, these aren't the only engines out there. There's multiple engines people can use. People could be using Leela Chess Zero, etc. So one of the things that they look at that most of you guys on the internet aren't thinking about is they're actually looking at move times. So when I'm playing a whole bunch of book moves, and I'm playing preparation, and I'm playing all perfect chess. So if I'm playing all this preparation and I'm playing all perfect chess, they're looking at how quickly I'm doing that. So if I'm doing that relatively quickly, You know, they know that I'm a titled player, you know, even though it's a low title, I'm only a national master. So they know that I've likely got all of that memorized. So they're expecting move times to happen pretty rapidly. So, like, even here, like, when I make this so-called brilliant move, I made this move in less than a second, which is an indicator to the algorithm that I am probably making that move with my preparation, and I am not consulting a secondary machine, or I'm not waiting for something to give me the move there. So it's not a question of how high the move ranks on the computer list. They're also looking at how long it takes me to make it. And it's a little anti-instinctual. You would think, like, the faster I make the moves, the more likely it is that I'm cheating. That's not actually true. What they're looking is for human-like wait times. You know, so, like, in a position in the opening where I would theoretically have everything memorized, they're looking for instant moves. And then the second I leave my preparation, they're looking for those prep times to start going up. So here after castles, it's conceivable this is still my prep. And then here I start eating up a little bit more clock time. I spend 2 seconds on A4, but A4 is still a pretty obvious progress making move. And then I'm starting to spend a little bit more time on each of these subsequent moves to make progress. And as you can see, just on a simple move like A4, A5, which a computer probably would have shot out immediately as the best move without a whole lot of time, this is a move that took me, like, roughly 11 seconds to play. So that's something that they're looking at, is what type of move times are we looking at? Are these human-like move times? And that's one of the ways that they do cheat detection, with these very complicated, you know, algorithms, is they're not just looking at how accurate are the moves, but what are the move times? So I grabbed another game that was more accurate than this one, because this was just to show you, yes, a national master can beat a grandmaster, and, you know, a 2400 can beat a 2500, and of course, you know, if that's possible, really, a 2700 can beat a 2800, if you're all curious. These are all possible results, so they do happen. Okay, so this is another game I played. I was rated a little bit higher, this one. This is more recently. You know, I'm getting my blitz rating up there, actually. On Lee Chess, my blitz rating's over 2500, and on Chess.com, it's hanging around the 2450s. So my blitz is getting better anyway. So this game, I had a really high accuracy. My accuracy was 97.4, and I've had higher than that. I've actually hit 100 one time, although it was a super short game. And, I've had a couple games in the 99.7s. So I've had some really high accuracy, so this is by no means my highest. But again, I want to point out why, even with this game, and I picked this game because it was a relatively long game where I had this really high accuracy, but all of it was theoretical. So this is all preparation, and as you can see, I'm playing all of my moves relatively quickly. And then I play a really old, this one in accuracy, this is a very old trap that was dates back to like the 1960s. It's something that Paul Karras came up with. So I play this trap, and I'm really familiar with all the theory after this trap. And so the rest of my moves are actually instant after the book blunder. Knight takes e4 is a well-known blunder in this position. And then I play everything correctly, you know, knight d5, and you can see my move times are hardly moving. I'm going to beat this guy, and I'm barely going to use any time on my clock at all. You can just look at these move times. He's eating up the clock like crazy, so it's very clear that he's out of book. But it's also very clear to any type of cheat detection algorithm that I am still clearly playing a position that I've played before. I'm moving, you know, less than a second, less than 2 seconds a move. At this point, you know, that move I played in less than a second, probably this whole game, now I'm eating up the clock. So right here we see this normal kind of human wait time. And this is something that happens that you'll see with humans when they are cheating, is like in these types of critical positions where white is like clearly breaking through, clearly winning. This is where a human being is going to pause and they're going to really think about it, because they know that if they get this right, they win the game. So they're going to double check, they're going to triple check, they're going to quadruple check if necessary. They're going to be very, very careful about this move, because they know that this is the most critical move of the game. They need to play this correctly. So you're going to see longer pause times in here towards the end, where there's actually a tactical solution, and white is going to be mating in 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. You know, whereas the computer will just spit this out and just show you, like, mate in 4. And if you're cheating, you're going to play those moves really quickly because the computer's just spitting it out. You're getting excited. You're going to play the moves quickly. If you're not a cheater, you're not going to play these moves quickly because you're busy double and triple checking your calculations. So here you can just see I'm eating up that clock time. You know, knight g8, I took forever on this because there's multiple ways that I can try to play for a mate from here. I found the correct move, and then again I found the correct move, and again I take eating up more clock time, double and triple checking that move. Only 2 seconds on that one, but by now I see the mate. So now I have queen g4 and then queen g4 mate. So queen g5, queen g4 mate. So what else goes into, you know, cheat detection? It's not just move times, and it's not just accuracy levels, like how close did they play to the computer. Although those are two of probably the biggest component. It's also they look at, you know, your overall picture. So they're looking at as many possible moves as they can look at. And the more and more moves they look at, what they do is they have an algorithm that comes up with the percentage likelihood that you're receiving assistance. And the more games you play, the more assistance that you use, the higher that percentage goes up. So the more people cheat or the more they cheat, the more likely it is that they can determine that you're cheating. So in a sense, if somebody, you know, and this is one thing that the internet does get a little right, is if somebody is using a limited cheating approach, like they only cheat for one or two moves and only against one player, it is really difficult to detect. Because what you would be doing is you would be giving a percentage of the likelihood that that person cheated. You would be looking at, you know, not just one game where they played 40 moves. You're going to be trying to look at like 1,000 moves to create kind of that fingerprint picture of their play and see how closely that corresponds with the move times, the wait times, and the accuracy levels of the average type of computer versus the average type of human player that's going to be playing these types of moves, and they'll come up with a percentage likelihood that that person is using assistance. So if it's kind of like going to a casino, if you go to a casino and you know, pull the slot machine and you win the very first time, and then you leave and you run out of the casino and you never ever gamble again, you know, you just beat the odds. And you can do that with cheating, I guess, if you only cheat one time, only cheat against one person, and only cheat for one move and never do it again. In theory, there is no way that you can accurately detect that with an algorithm. But of course, people that cheat, they cheat more than once. That's how Hans Niemann got caught on the internet when he was cheating, is he clearly did this a lot more than once. In order for anyone to get caught cheating, they need to do it a lot more than once. They can't just cheat in one or two games. They got to cheat for enough moves to where they can basically create that fingerprint and they can figure out if that person is cheating. They need enough moves to figure out if somebody's cheating. But, you know, without giving away too much on the algorithm, you know, it's just like if you look at the game that Hans Niemann played against Magnus Carlsen, just based on that one game, it is absolutely impossible to tell that he cheated. But more importantly, like the fingerprints for that game, like the move times, the accuracy levels, they don't. Everybody that I've talked to that is actually really into this stuff, actually looking at, you know, computer cheating, they all say that the likelihood that he cheated in that game or in the rest of the Singfield Cup is highly unlikely. Just highly unlikely. And again, it's not just looking at the accuracy level or if he picked the second or third pick on the computer or something like that. It's also looking at the move times. It's also looking at the wait times. It's also looking at where human beings tend to spend their times in the openings, in the end games, in the finishing positions, in positions where they're, you know, tactically winning, where they have mate in three, where they have mate in four. Human beings spend more time in positions that computers find simple, and human beings spend less time in positions that computers will spend more time. And I know that's anti-instinctual, but human beings will not spend very much time in the opening because we've looked at all of the engine readout, and we will actually move faster than computers. And, you know, in some cases we can go for, you know, 22, 23, 24, 27 moves of theory, where a computer, if you run the engine, if you don't have the book loaded, it will take an enormous amount of time to analyze that position, but we've already sat at home and analyzed it all on our computer. So basically, home preparation, human beings are going to spit out really, really quickly as compared to a machine. But then when you get to those finishing type positions, those positions in the end game or those positions where you have mate in four, mate in five, a computer is going to spit out a really fast answer, whereas a human being is naturally going to double check and triple check his move to make sure that it works. And that's how we detect cheaters. We detect whether or not people are doing unhuman-like things during the game. It's not just a raw look at, hey, this person had a 97 accuracy, or this person had a 99 accuracy when we compared it to Stockfish 15 or Ribka or whatever computer we think they may have been using. No, that's not how it works. We're looking for basically like a fingerprint of human play versus computer play. And that's how it works. And if Hans Niemann does get caught for cheating in live tournaments, it's likely that these are the types of algorithms and this is the type of investigation that they're going to be using to catch that kind of thing. And if he did cheat against Magnus Carlsen, I doubt that he'll do it only one time. He'll probably cheat against other players in other events. If he's really not a legitimate 2700, he's going to have to do that to maintain his 2700 rating. And eventually he will be caught by an algorithm, because that's just how these things work. If you get 1,000 moves that you can look at, you start being able to tell with more and more certainty whether or not somebody cheated. So anyways, that's how cheat detection works. And I just wanted to add that as kind of my two cents into this controversy, is how we actually detect cheating and how cheat detection works. And if there is cheating involved, that's the type of investigation that's going to be going on. Like I said in previous videos, I don't think there was any cheating going on. There certainly wasn't any cheating going on, or at least as far as I can tell, in the Singfield Cup. But, you know, again, we need to wait for official statements, and we need to find out what the experts think about this so that we can have a more clear understanding of kind of what's going on. So anyways, I hope that you found this video helpful. I hope you learned something new about chess, or at the very least, I hope you learned something new about how cheat detection is done, or basically a rough outline on how cheat detection is done, so that you have a better idea on what people are looking at when they're actually looking into this controversy. Thank you very much for watching.